Good morning, Wentzes.
Morning.
Come on, good morning, Wentzes.
Good morning.
All right, get a little energy going on. Come on, stand to your feet as we sing our opening hymn. Welcome to, this is what we're calling Fifth Sunday Shenanigans. Every month that has five Sundays, we're gonna try to do a little something. And this Sunday, our young people are going to be really participating in service, and we're all young, right?
Amen.
Y'all didn't believe that one. You didn't believe one word of that. You didn't believe one word of that. Sing with us. With us. Since Jesus came into my heart, what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Change since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into buzz of joy, oh my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since verse 2, I have ceased from my wandering, going astray. Since Jesus came into my heart, and my sin. Request. Just keep playing the chorus softly as Chip comes. Just keep playing the chorus. There you go. That's wonderful. I love that. It's all yours, Chip.
All right.
Keep standing if you would.
Please join me as we state our church's mission. Welcome all into a loving, inclusive faith community, seeking to live out the teachings of Jesus, building on our own rich history, actively exploring beliefs and assumptions, and promoting justice, peace, and spiritual growth.
For you, O Lord, are my hope.
My trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have learned from my birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb.
My praise is continually of you.
My mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all day long.
Do not cast me off in the name of old age. Do not forsake me when my strength is spent. I will hope continually and will praise you yet more and more.
My mouth will tell of your righteous acts, of your deeds. deeds of salvation all day long.
I will come praising the mighty deeds of the Lord God. I will praise your righteousness, yours alone.
O God, from my youth you have taught me, and I still claim your wondrous deeds.
So even to old age and gray hairs, O God, do not forsake me. I proclaim your might to all the generations to come.
Hold on a minute, Chip. Hold on a minute. Can somebody get Chip a music stand instead of watching him struggle with the music?
Thank you.
Come on, put your hands in. You know that you love them, you appreciate them. You're good. It's good to see you this morning. God bless you. Good morning, YouTube. Good morning, Myrna. Myrna, me and you, I need to have a conversation at the church. Stand to your feet as we sing the Lord's Prayer. Our young people are dismissed. Young people, you can chip. They can stay or they can go downstairs with you, whatever.
We have more to do, so we're heading downstairs.
Okay.
We're also hosting coffee hours. We have snacks for
everybody. See? The young people run the place. I have no idea what's going on. Now, stand to your feet as we sing the Lord's Prayer. Standing to your feet as we sing our sermonic song, How Great Thou Art, and I will be back with the meditation of the hour.
Thank you.
still standing, let's read together our scripture text for this morning. Very familiar text, Psalms 23. Let's do it together. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valleys, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. God, you have to help us now. Prepare our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. I want to, as you see in your bulletin, I'm using as a thought this morning, keep calm and carry on. They are only shadows. Keep calm and carry on. They are only shadows. Scripture says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, in one version, our version says the darkest valleys. Keep calm and carry on. Put it this way, the spooky season is here. The spooky season is here. Y'all mind if I preach in a hat? Because I think I look kind of cool in a hat. I just want to make sure. And we're on YouTube, so I'm trying to keep this, you know, in perpetuity. So, you know, they got a cool pastor over there at Wentz's. He's in his sixth hat, sixth jersey. All right. Amen. All right. So the spooky season is upon us. And to be honest, I'm not a big Halloween person. Even when I was younger, I participated because that's what my friends were doing, right? And so I did it too. I love the fall. I do. I love the fall. When my boys were a certain age, we participated for sure. As it becomes sweater weather, and starts to get dark earlier, quick side note, I wasn't sure if I was late or Bill was early this morning, and we both had to confer, did the clocks fall back this morning? I wasn't sure. But as it gets dark earlier, the smells and sounds that perk up our senses of the fall are all wonderful to me. Although, to tell the truth, Hallmark and its various channels are trying to ruin it for me. Because, you know, they run Christmas movies that start October 1. Now, seriously, how many ways can you put out Lonely Rider Goes to New England at Christmas, falls in love with the local just widowed lumberjack? Right? How many ways can we tell that story between now and January 1? Okay, I'm not opposed to that story. I just don't need it for 3 months. Just putting it out there. So when my boys were small, they shared a room. First bunk beds, and then as they got older, the beds were unbunked, and they always had lots of toys and junk in their room. We had more broken pieces of stuff in their room when they were small. And one of their toys was an Incredible Hulk piggy bank. It was the bust, one that you might see the size of in like a museum or something, of that green monster. And once in the middle of the night, I heard a bunch of banging and crashing in the boys' room, and I ran into their room. Well, I really didn't run. Y'all know me well. Oh, no. So, no, I wasn't running anywhere, right? So sat on the side of the bed, got myself together, let the blood run down to my feet so I can get some feeling in my feet, and then I went to see what was happening. And it turns out, I got into the room, and I said, what's wrong? And one of the boys said, as he grabbed me, he said, there's a monster in here. He's over there, and he pointed to the dark corner of the room where the shadows lurk in the shape of this monster. And I said, it's just a shadow. It's just a shadow. And I walked over and picked up the Hawk piggy bank. The position of the moonlight and that green piggy bank were just right to cast an ominous looking shadow. Now, I don't want to minimize evil, evil in the world. Evil is real and has a profound impact on our lives, how we engage the world. You know, just the other day we saw all over the news that the gunman in Maine who shot up a bowling alley and a bar, killing some 18 people, then later ending his own life. The horrific events in the Middle East a few weeks ago and an ongoing tragedy, and now the escalating violence. There is evil all around us. And at times it feels unrestrained, even if we aren't facing it daily in our lives. We know shadows and dark places and shadows of evil can be scary. Sometimes we feel like we are navigating through life's challenges almost completely in the dark. It's easy to convince ourselves that we are doomed when we judge things by only what we see. But we need to have the kind of faith that David had, who said, although I walk in the darkest valley, or the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. The valley of the shadow of death, the darkest valley, is a symbolic description of the state of the world. We walk through this symbolic valley of darkness and death as part of our human experience. Shadows are all around us. There's no place we can go to escape it. The shadows that come into our lives reflect the presence of all the things, whether evil or good or indifferent, in the world. Y'all still with me? So, but for David, a shepherd, the valley of the shadow of death, or the darkest valley, was a location, a dangerous place. There really was and still is a valley of the shadow of death in the Holy Land. It is south of the Jericho Road, a narrow gorge that cuts through the mountain range leading from Jerusalem to the Dead Sea. Poor grazing conditions made it necessary for shepherds to quickly move their herds through this gorge, this shadow, or this dark valley between towering mountains that blotted out the sun. Unpredictable weather in the gorge often made the journey treacherous. There was nowhere to seek shelter if the weather suddenly turned foul. And the worst part was the valley was 4 miles long. David expressed his trust in the Lord, takes on a whole new meaning once you understand what he faced as a shepherd driving his herd. Yes, although I walk through the darkest valley and the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because you are with me. David isn't the only one who spoke of this shadow of death or this dark valley. It was a common expression among the early Hebrew nationals. The Hebrew word here, it meant shade of death or the grave. The Hebrews saw death as a permanent separation from God. This explains why Job thought he was in the shadow of death. You all know the story. He lost his livestock, his livelihood, his home, his family, and finally his good health in chapter 3 of his said book. In verse 5, he said, "Let this day perish when I was born." And he begs for the shadow of death to come and stain or swallow him up in his agony. 14 times Job wails that he is in this shadow of death as he wonders about aloud before God how he ended up this way. Have you ever wondered aloud before God, how, God, did we get in this situation? God, how did I get from this point to that point? God, what happened to me? Finally, the Lord had enough of Job's complaining and wailing, because you know we complain, right? And he had to speak to Job forcefully, and Job to let him know. He said, "Listen, Job." God said, "Listen here, Job. Gird yourself. Gird up your loins. Man up." Verse Job 38 and 3. This is what he says. He says, "Gird up your loins like a man. It's time for me to question you and let me see if you know the answers." In other words, you claim to know so much about your condition, Job. Now it's my turn to ask you some questions to see just how wise you are. And then the Lord gave Job the what for. Job complained so much that God had to tell him to be still, keep calm, and carry on. Y'all with me? In our lifetime, we faced our own shadows of death and dark places, and nevermore during all the things that we are dealing with now. When trouble comes, we are just like Job. When trouble comes, we sometimes think this must be the big one. And we turn to God with the same question that Job had. Why me? First, let me say this to you. Troubles are only shadows. They seem monstrous at times because their presence weighs heavily upon us. Trouble has a way of getting us to take our eyes off the prize. Life's troubles create doubt. Life's anxiety tries to weaken our blessed assurance. Sickness tries to convince us there is no balm in Gilead. Hostility tries to destroy our peace. Failure wants to convince us that we will never succeed. Wickedness will come against our desire for righteousness, and lies will try to cause us to miss our blessing. But David said, as we sang earlier, I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and so shall I be saved from my enemies. Shadows can be frightening no matter what shape they take. Shadows will control you and I if we let them. Shadows try to deceive God's people, discourage God's people or the work of God, deride the miracles of God, defeat the plan of God, defy the wisdom of God, and depress the people of God. But like David, with faith, we can overcome our troubles. Doesn't matter how deep the valley or how high the mountain. It doesn't matter how rocky the road or how perilous the crossing. These valleys and these dark places are only shadows of our lives, nighttime experiences. If we hold on to the light of Christ, joy comes in the morning because Christ has overcome the world. Y'all still with me? Then trials come. Trials are teaching time. Job could not understand how his life could have gone so wrong so quickly. Scholars have tried for centuries to explain why Job had to suffer so much. And while it's true that God withdrew his hedge of protection from around Job, the reality is that trials are part of life. If you don't have any issues in your life, keep living. Amen. Keep living. Trials come. Jesus attested, in the world you will have tribulation. David had trials, and not just in the valley of the shadow of death. King Saul sought to kill him. David's own son Absalom led an army of haters against him. And then there were the shadows that David brought on himself. It's not the trial itself that's significant. It's when we learn in the midst of the trials that matters. God uses the trials to teach us lessons we would not otherwise learn. Andre Crouch, the songwriter, wrote, he said, if I've never had a problem, how would I know that God could solve it? I've learned to trust and depend on God. God uses trials just not to test our faith, but to teach us how to overcome adversity. Job learned during his test how little he knew about God, but he also learned how great and powerful God really is. And when the shadows disappeared, God was faithful to restore Job's life and livelihood. Finally, troubles lead us to victory. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever been at the end of your rope? Have you ever been like me that you say, you know, I've reached the end of this rope and I don't know if I can keep holding on, but I've learned to just tie a knot and hold on. The Lord will fashion a way out of whatever the situation is. The old saints used to say, where I come from, they say he will make a way out of no way. And if faith is the evidence of things not seen, you and I will just have to trust God, and he will give you and I the desires and the need of our hearts. Peter said it this way, therefore, let those suffering according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto the faithful creator. God is faithful to the faithful. God is faithful to the faithful. He will keep his covenant with those who follow him. You keep your end of the covenant, and you know the if part, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their ways, then they will hear from heaven. You keep that part, and God will keep his part, and he will heal the land. That's the end of that verse. You've got to stand firm and be unshakable foundation from God, what God has promised in your heart. If you do that, you will survive the darkest of the nights. You think you have troubles. You think this is the big one. And if I'm taking my cue from David and Job, I am going to gird up my loins, man up or woman up, whatever it is your thing that you do, right? The truth that comes from God is that God will see us through. They are only shadows. And when in the midst of that darkest valley, God will encourage you and I until the shadow of despair disappears. He will strengthen you when the shadow of weakness threatens. He will guide us when the shadow of doubt looms. He will guide us and assure us when shadow of anxiety lurks. He will hold us close when the shadow of a heartache brings sorrow. The Lord will bring the past, the victories we are praying for. Our darkest nights will be followed by the brightest of days. You have to believe that. Our heaviest of burdens will be followed by the greatest of blessings. We have to learn to keep calm and carry on. I think sometimes life has a way of happening that we panic. One of the things I've learned in this life, get ready, June, is don't make permanent decisions based on temporary circumstances. Don't make permanent decisions based on temporary circumstances. It may look one way today, but give it time. But give it time. And let me give you an example. You give it time. I have a friend who was having some money issues. So they went out and they got this big loan with a high interest rate. If he'd have just gave it 4 more months, the situation turned around. Don't make permanent decisions based on temporary circumstances. I'm putting it get a different way. You may be in school or a child in school and they may be struggling this semester. Doesn't mean they're gonna struggle every semester. Don't up and quit. Give it some time. God bless you. Keep calm and carry on.